History is not just something you have to learn in books. It's alive and growing in places across the world. Hi, I'm Alan Smith. Today we're going to have a look at some beautiful historic gardens. The way I see it, when I want to enjoy and learn something about art, I go to a museum. But if I want inspiration and ideas for my garden, I visit exceptional gardens, like this one, the Mission in Carmel, California. Then it's off to the fertile delta land of the mighty Mississippi River for a spring pilgrimage and the restoration of a New Orleans treasure. Finally, we'll cross over the Atlantic and visit a living museum in Holland, where time seems to stand still, at least for the tulips. Plus, I'll have a few gardening tips as well to help you preserve a little history in your own garden. So stay with us. Our nation's history is a rich and diverse one, so it shouldn't be any surprise that our garden history is equally diverse. For instance, while the President and Mrs. Washington were creating gardens in the English style at Mount Vernon on the East Coast, on the West Coast, the Spanish missionaries were creating gardens influenced by their own traditions. This mission was founded in 1770, on the eve of the War for American Independence from Britain. It's hard to imagine that over 750,000 visitors come to this beautiful mission and its gardens each year to learn more about our early American history, Western style.
We often forget that at the same time Jamestown was founded on the eastern coast of the United States, Spain sent an expedition along the western coast of the United States as a map-making expedition. And it is they who named this place Carmel, the oldest name to appear on a map of the United States, taken from its namesake in the Holy Land, meaning Garden of God.
Sir Richard Minn has been the curator for the missions at San Carlos Borromeo in Carmel, California for over 25 years. He's dedicated to preserving the integrity of this mission and its beautiful gardens.
A lot of the original purpose has changed, although they still provide an area for both enjoyment and for the raising of herbs and a little bit of food cultivation. The area that we're standing in now was originally the kitchen garden for the mission itself, and vegetables used on the table of the Padres were grown in this area and is known to be California's earliest vegetable garden. As a matter of fact, it is noted that Junipero Serra chose this very site because it reminded him of his birthplace on the island of Mallorca.
Now, the first house built here near the Carmel Mission was for an orchardist and his family.
Yes, alongside the mission itself, Father Serra wanted to provide for the food of the table by having orchards and kitchen gardens close to the mission itself. And this area, which was once as large as 13 acres, housed 360 pear trees and required to have a man living here to take care of the trees and to run the wildlife out of the property who would eat the pears. The trees were cuttings brought from Spain. They were a peculiar type of pear called peritos de San Juan, or pears of St. John, and four of those trees still stand in this garden, leftovers from the period of the early mission.
There are so many wonderful things to see. From the mission grounds to the many exquisite gardens, you really should plan to spend the whole day. And what a way to be able to gather lots of ideas to take back to your own garden.
People are drawn here for many reasons, not only to view the historical artifacts in the museums or on religious pilgrimage, or just a sense of peace in the gardens. It's also become the favorite venue of the world-class musical festival known as the Carmel Bach Festival. Traditionally, on Wednesday nights, the performance here at the Mission is done entirely by candlelight. It's a tradition that started in the 40s by the founders of the festival. Few people realize that the origins of the candlelight concert were due to the fact that during the rehearsal for the first performance, the electrical wiring was burned out of the church walls by overtaxing the system. But it's become a favorite ever since, and regardless of the fact that we have since corrected the problem, people tend to enjoy the candlelight a lot more.
Spring is a time of year when so much is going on. Flowers are coming up everywhere and there's so much beauty around us. It's the perfect time for spring festivals. Tulips, cherry blossoms, and daffodils all have been the inspiration for events in many communities. Since the early 1930s, the city of Natchez, Mississippi has been opening its beautiful homes and gardens to the public. This has been a way to help preserve these historic places and at the same time celebrate spring. Ron Miller, a longtime resident of Natchez, is an author and historian and is the executive director of the Historic Natchez Foundation. He and others like him are dedicated to preserving some of the beautiful historic homes and landscapes in the area. Ron, how long has the pilgrimage been going on here in Natchez?
Well, the Natchez Pilgrimage began in 1932. It makes it the second oldest organized house tour in the nation. It started just a few years after the Virginia House and Garden Tours began. It was begun in response to a tour that had been held the year before in 1931 for the Mississippi Garden Clubs. It was held in the spring, like the spring pilgrimage is still held today. And they had a cold snap and the gardens were miserable. So they opened the houses and brought the garden club members into the houses. And it was such a hit that the garden club in Natchez decided that's what they needed to do, is do it again, but do it this time for money. So they did it in 1932.
That's a wonderful story. So it's because of a lot of frozen camellias and azaleas, people yes. got into the houses.
Yeah. And that still happens sometimes.
Well, I'm sure the number of visitors to Natchez has increased over the years.
It has. There was a meeting before the city alderman in 1925. An old lady trying to prevent the demolition of the old city hall said that she had noted that last year there were two tourists to Natchez and surely the number would grow in the future. So when the first pilgrimage began, they were very gratified over those few days to see that hundreds of people came. And now we have, over a year's time, hundreds of thousands of people who are coming to Natchez.
So all of these large houses that visitors see today were actually suburban villas, and the plantations themselves were in outer regions.
Exactly. There were some plantations on the uplands, the rolling lands, but without floods to enrich the soil, their soil gave out. So what the planters built as their main houses here at Natchez, some of them even call them summer houses, were these, as they said, suburban villas. We think of it as a modern term, but it's really, that's the old historic term for houses like Monmouth.
Because of the effort and support of this community towards the preservation of its beautiful architecture and magnificent gardens, combined with warm hospitality, it offers a most inviting environment for visitors from near and far. People are coming in droves to Natchez today, but there seems to be a precedent for that. I mean, this area attracted people long ago.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's on the Great River, so that's the highway of America, where everybody would travel up and down. It was been a big trading point all along. And that's what attracted the first settlers, was that rich uplands. But more than that, it's the fact that some of the highest bluffs come up right next to the river's edge here at Natchez. That's very rare. Wherever you find it, you find old settlements, and of them all, Natchez is the oldest established settlement along the Mississippi River.
The azalea, and I should say the camellia, are two plants that figure prominently in the landscapes here in Natchez and all the gardens. When's the first account of these plants? Because they're both foreign, they both come from the Far East.
Well, I know that in the 1830s and 40s, the day books of a Mrs. Turnbull at Rosedown Plantation, 60 miles south of here at St. Francisville, Louisiana, documents that she was planting Oriental azaleas in her gardens there and tending them, again in the shade of the live oak trees that make the great alley up to the house. And visitors to Natchez in the 40s and 50s and the 30s talked about the evergreen bushes that were here flowering that looked like the flowers had been enameled onto the greenery.
I guess they were talking about camellias.
It sure fits that description.
If you missed the spring tour, don't worry. Now many of the homes and gardens are open for a fall pilgrimage and during the Christmas holiday season. Now we'll roll down the river, the Mississippi that is, and we'll help uncover what might be one of the best kept secrets of New Orleans. Nestled inside the botanical gardens of New Orleans lies City Park. At one time, this park lay in total disrepair. But today, thanks to the efforts of New Orleans native Jen Trimble and others like her, City Park is enjoying its own renaissance.
City Park is really one of the hidden jewels of New Orleans. As you can see, it's a very small garden. It's only 10 acres. And during the 1930s, in the midst of the Depression, WPA came in here. At that time, 10 acres of this 1,500-acre park was set aside, designated, and designed as a garden. It was simply called the Rose Garden. Later on, it was to become known as the Botanical Garden, which it is today. And during the 1930s, from old photographs we have, this evidently flourished in here. People would come here, and why? Because it had been really designed to afford the public who were in the midst of this terrible economic depression the horticultural privilege and pleasure of coming to an ornamental public garden. Then, as the years progressed, by the 1970s, this became a woebegone, forgotten place. Only left were these magnificent pieces of sculpture, which were done by an artist, a Mexican artist named Enrique Alferez, who was just an unknown artist in the 1930s, now is nationally, even internationally known. I do think that the keynote of our redevelopment of this garden and the principal thing that this garden says is what can be done and what really must be done by the general public and people in the community to help preserve and restore our landscape, which is our heritage. A garden has to have people in it. People to work and people to enjoy.
By definition, really.
By definition. Yeah. And so we are getting more and more, thousands and thousands more people coming in here. And it's so wonderful to see the community turning to City Park and to this botanical garden. Everything
has a history, including flowers. And one with an interesting and extensive history is the tulip. So it shouldn't surprise us that it would have its own museum. Here at the Hortus Bulborum in Lehman, Holland, there's over 400 years of tulip history in full bloom. Chris Van Keeken, a steward of the Hortus Bulborum, gave me a tour last spring. Chris, what is the main objective of the Hortus Bulborum?
Well, the main purpose is for many people who come here collect pollen from old varieties so they can crossbreed with new varieties and to get characteristics of the old varieties back into the new ones, you see. We have about 1,500 varieties of very old tulips. If you just want to look at this variety, this Lac van den Rijn, that was introduced in the year 1620.
The amazing thing to me about this living museum is that in order to preserve these different varieties of tulips, someone has had to dig and store them ever since they were first introduced. Now that's quite a commitment when you consider many of these varieties are several hundred years old.
This is a living museum. As you see, it's an open air museum. As I usually say, we have no roof here. It's just an open air museum.
It
can't be helped, otherwise you can't grow them.
Here's an old shrub rose that your grandmother may have known. This is the old-fashioned sweetheart rose, or sometimes known by its French name as Cecile Bruner. It made its debut in 1881, and it's a tough, old, reliable rose. But you know, the great thing about this plant is that it blooms constantly. See, look at all of these sprays of tiny pink roses. As soon as one cluster fades, the bush throws off another set of blooms, and this goes on until the first frost. By keeping the dead flowers removed, or using them as cut flowers, you encourage the plant to produce more blooms. The more you cut, the more it blooms. What a deal! Because this plant flowers so much, I fertilize about every 3 to 4 weeks or so with a fertilizer specifically blended for roses. Then, after I've applied it, I water it in. Now, this plant is already about 5 feet tall, and I only planted it 3 years ago, so you can see they're very fast growers. It also comes in a climbing form, where its canes can reach up to 25 feet long, perfect for growing on an arbor or a fence. Now, I grow a lot of old-fashioned roses in my garden, but always save room for a Cecile Bruner because she'll bloom her heart out. I can't imagine my garden without roses. Their fragrance and beauty, well, it's hard to beat. You know, I grow over 30 different varieties of roses in my garden, and I'm often asked, how do you take care of them all? Well, it's all in how you choose them. You see, some rose varieties are just easier to care for than others. Many of the roses I grow are old-fashioned shrub roses. Now, you can find these old-fashioned roses from a variety of sources these days, but in the past, they were actually handed from one gardener to the next from stem cuttings. Now, making stem cuttings actually occurs later in the summer, once the flowers have faded and the new growth has matured just a bit. Let me show you how the process works. It all begins with selecting just the right stems, ones that are just under the diameter of a pencil. I make my cuts at an angle just above a leaf node, making sure the cutting is at least 4 to 5 inches long and has a couple of sets of leaves. With your cuttings selected, you'll want to treat them just as you would fresh cut flowers. Get them in water immediately before moving to the next step. First, start with any container that can be covered and sealed with plastic. Then fill it with a loose soil medium like potting soil or vermiculite. Now make sure you moisten the medium you're planting in, and always make my holes first before slipping the cuttings in. Now, to encourage those roots to develop, stick the ends of the cuttings into a rooting powder or hormone before putting them into the planting medium. You'll find that certain roses actually root better than others. If you'd like a list of roses I've had good success in rooting, just check out our website. From the old to the newly renovated, gardens of all types have fed us. They provided us places of refuge, and they have even kept alive a glimpse of our past. I hope that our travels today have inspired you to get involved in some type of gardening that allows you to preserve a little of our history, as well as some beauty for all to enjoy. From the garden, I'm Alan Smith. Thank you.
this garden I dream of a bed of flowers. Bluebirds sing of the beauty all around us. And every time the sun comes out, I can't help but smile. Oh, no, I can't help but smile.